So how do you make friends with reality? And then what's really real? I mean, what's real? Is it all the stuff out here? Or is it that which is in here, that which is in your heart? So there's your question. What's real? What's keeping you tethered to unreality? What keeps you tethered to that which makes you unhappy and stressed and anxious? And how can you untether yourself so that you can experience reality? I've got to tell you a story about what happened to me almost 40 years ago. I was going through a very difficult time, and a friend of mine said, "You need to go to a resort." I had never been to a resort. I grew up in the streets of Oakland. My dad owned a hardware store, and we did not go to resorts. We barely went to Boy Scout camps. So I'd never been to a resort, but I had just enough money to do it. And it was an all-inclusive resort, and so everything that you wanted to do, you could do for an hour. You could check into things for an hour. So the first day, I saw people out there windsurfing. I'd never windsurfed. I'd never had an opportunity to. I thought, I'm going to windsurf. So I went up to the guy. I realized later that he really didn't want to do his job because he said to me, "Have you ever surfed?" And I said, "No, I've never surfed at that time." And he said, "Well, you could never windsurf if you haven't surfed." So I kind of slunk off. 2 days later, I'm watching all these people windsurfing. I'm thinking, oh, I want to do that. So I went up to him. I said, "Come on, can you just like give me an easy lesson for windsurfing and I'll try it?" And he said, "Have you ever sailed a boat?" And I said, "No, I've never sailed a boat." And he said, "Oh, there's no way you could windsurf." So I slunk off. I mean, do you let the world tell you what you can and can't do? I did. And I watched this until I got to the very last day of the week. And the very last day of the week, I finally realized, when is when over? When is that when it's right over? I decided I was just going to take the bull by the horns and I was going to do it. So I went up to the guy and said, "I'm going to windsurf." And he said, "Well, I don't have time to teach you." I said, "Well, at least give me a 1 minute lesson on how to hold it or whatever, where to stand." So he gave me a rudimentary, maybe 2 minutes, showed me what to do. And yeah, it wasn't real easy, but I figured I could do something with it. So he left. And I got up on the windsurf board, and the first time a gust of wind came, I fell into the water. So I tried it again. Gust of wind, fell into the water. This happened for at least 200 times. I did this for 45 minutes. I was so stubborn and so insistent that I was going to windsurf that I just kept doing it, but I was getting sore, and I was getting really tired. And the guy, I see him walking towards me with a disgusted look on his face. And he walks up to me and he says, "What are you still doing here?" And I said, "Every time I try to get up, a wind gust hits me and I get thrown in the water." And he looks at me and he goes down like this and he goes, click. I'd been tethered to the dock. So for the next 15 minutes, I had a relatively good time. I fell in the water a few times, but it was a different experience. And I was actually kind of able to do it. I went on to become certified when I went back home, and I had a great experience windsurfing. My point is not about windsurfing or persistence or any of that stuff. It's about what is tethering you to the dock. There's something, there's a belief that you're holding that's keeping you stuck, tethered to keeping you from enjoying the beautiful windsurfing of life, the experience of life, the happiness of life. Well, I thought about that in my life, and I realized the thing that keeps me tethered the most is the belief that all this out here is what's real, instead of what is here inside. What's real for you? What's really real? You say, well, that looks kind of real. But truly, you experience happiness and joy to the extent that you are internally motivated rather than externally motivated, that you believe that that which is real is inside your heart. It's that smile that's in your heart, that gentle spirit that's in your heart, and in everybody else's heart too. If we had a Venn diagram of two people, you and me, there would be something we hold in common. And what is that? It's the love that's in our hearts. You're wearing glasses. You have pigtails. You're wearing a checkered shirt. You're taller than I am. You're smarter than I am, etc. All of those things, but there's something we hold in common. And what is it we hold in common? We call it the Christ in you. It's that which is the same. A friend of mine once said, "I used to be different, but now that I'm the same." And what is it that's the same? It's the spiritual you. It's that part of you that you can get in touch with, but it's what's real in you. Martha Creek will be here next week, and I highly recommend that you come on Saturday if you are interested in leadership in the church. But she loves to say, "It's reality, honey. Make friends with it." It's reality, honey. Make friends with it. That means this is just the way it is. Jesus said, the rain falls and the sun shines and the good and the bad and like. That's why God loves us just like that, and we need to love each other like that. Not conditional. That's where he talks about unconditional love, whether it's sun or rain, whether it's good or bad, whether we like it or not. And he said, my peace I give to you. I don't give like the world gives. How does the world give? Conditionally. And I love the analogy. I've shared it before, and you've heard it a million times, of are you a thermostat or a thermometer? If you're a thermometer, if it's 95 degrees and 100% humidity, you're miserable because you're just taking the temperature of what's going on out here and determining your happiness based upon it. But what is a thermostat? A thermostat regulates. Self-regulate. So if it's 95 degrees and 100% humidity, something kicks in. How do you do that? You say, well, how do I go down to Home Depot and get one of those thermostats? I want to be a person who's self-regulated. You know, every day on the news, you hear things you don't want to hear. So often on Sunday mornings, I show up in a church and there's been some tragedy the day before or the night before, and I've got to address a congregation, but I always address people on the level of spiritual principle because it's the way to self-regulate so that when you do have an opportunity to take action in the world, you can do so from a sane, sober, and spiritual place. So this is about regulating yourself. It's the old serenity prayer. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, the wisdom to know the difference. It's knowing what's yours to do and what's not yours to do. And what's not yours to do is to think that all this out there is for you to fix. Yeah, that doesn't mean that you shouldn't take action, but think about Jesus. He had injustices that were far worse than in our day, and I'm not making light of ours, but a quarter to a third of the people he was facing in his crowds were slaves. I mean, we're dealing with things now, but he was always dealing with people on the level of spiritual principle, and I know that's not always the most popular place, but it's the transformative place. Gandhi and King and all the great spiritual teachers who worked in the world to make a difference all regulated themselves with their spiritual practices, and they were public about it. What are your spiritual practices? What are you doing to turn yourself from a thermometer into a thermostat? What are you doing to regulate yourself? How many of you have heard of the happiest man in the world? His name is Matthew Ricard. Anybody hear of him? He's on TED Talks and a number of things. He's a Frenchman who received a... He was the son of a very famous, he's still alive, French economic philosopher. And he was raised in a very intellectual home. He got his PhD in molecular biology to keep his parents happy. And once he got his degree, he flew to Nepal and became a Tibetan Lama, and he's been one ever since. But the reason why they call him the most happy man in the world, which he doesn't like that title, although he laughs about it, is that he spent over 100 hours in MRIs getting his brain looked at because he's been meditating all these years, and somehow his brain has changed in such a way that all the markers of happiness are there. Now you say, what are the markers of happiness in my brain, and how can I don't know, do that? Well, you can, and he says that. And if Google this guy, happiest man in the world, he'll show right up. Because in the study they did at the University of Wisconsin of over 100 people, he was by far the happiest person physiologically in terms of his brain. Now, what's the difference between unhappy and happy? It's real simple. The right side of the front of your brain, your prefrontal cortex, is where if you have a lot of energy there, that's a sign that you have anxiety, a lot of anxiety. And if it's on the left side, it means that you have contentment, well-being, what we call happiness. And that they found that by teaching people how to meditate 20 minutes a day for 6 weeks, they could profoundly move that set point, the energy, farther to the left. And weirder than that, when the people would drop out of the program and be tested a year later, If they stopped meditating, some of them, if they kept meditating, it kept turning to the left. But even those people, even though it went back to the right, if they dropped out, it still was way better than it was before. It's a permanent change. So he says, this guy, Matthew Ricard, that you can learn the skill of spiritual happiness, and that's not pleasure or excitement or ego gratification, but it's that inner something that really lasts, that really matters. You can learn it like you can learn any skill, like learn how to play tennis or golf or chess or do anything, if you'll just simply apply yourself to it. And one of the ways is to meditate. And I know a lot of people think, well, I don't know how to meditate. When I try to meditate, my mind wanders. Well, duh, that's what minds do. And so the idea of meditation is you watch your mind wander. When it wanders, you let it wander. You watch it. And as Eckhart Tolle says, when you watch something, you're conscious. And when you're conscious, your ego can't be in it because your ego's unconscious. So you are watching. By watching your unconsciousness, you become conscious and you're no longer in your ego. It works. So you stop judging yourself because that's just an excuse we make. Oh, I don't do it good enough. Well, nobody does. He probably doesn't. I don't know. But he does it is the idea. So take something in your life and put it to work. Now, a lot of us read spiritual books, and I love reading spiritual books, and that can be a very good thing to do before you go to bed or as part of your thing every day. But don't let that take the place of using what's in the spiritual book to transform your inner awareness in your heart. I remember a woman came to me in my very first church, and she said, I've been reading all these books. I've been reading them for years, and it's just not working for me. And as we explored it and talked about it, we talked about the kinds of books she read. She listed all these books. She read them all. But when I asked her, what are you doing every day? You know, what are you doing each day in terms of your own practices, using affirmations or visualization or meditation or journaling or something? She didn't do any of it. I said, you're starving to death reading cookbooks. So what's happening is that you take a recipe, one recipe, just take one. And cook it, and then eat it. Use something that you're reading. And it's a wonderful thing to read spiritual things. But as a minister friend of mine said, sometimes people get more good from the exercise of stacking of the books than reading them because they're not applying them. So take something and put it to work in your life. And it's something that's very, very simple. What did Einstein say? The truth, make it as simple as you can, but no simpler. But it's a simple truth. It's the simple truth. And what you'll find is by practicing, you'll actually physiologically change your brain. We're talking about a kind of happiness that is not conditional, is not according to effects. You say, but there's injustice. There are bad things happening in the world. Somebody's got to do something. Yeah, but if you're going to do something, you got to be sane first. You got to be out of that hair on fire, outrage, in order to make a difference in the world, whatever it is that you're supposed to do. And the only way that you'll know, have the wisdom to know the difference, according to the Serenity Prayer, is to do your spiritual practices. So Jesus talked about this all the time. He talked about happiness and contentment in a very strange way. He often likened it to things that look negative to us. He said, I give you peace. By peace I give to you. And it's peace that passes understanding, which basically means peace that you can never figure out. Peace that doesn't make any conscious sense because it's not conditional. It's not based on the conditions of the world, what your mother is doing, what your child is doing, what your spouse or your sister is doing, what's going on at your work, your numbers, your bank balance, any of those. It's a peace that you bring to the world. And Jesus, his most famous quote on this is something that is often misquoted because it's been mistranslated. What are the first two words of all of the Beatitudes? Do you remember? Blessed are. Blessed are. Did you think he said that? He didn't say that. That's a mistranslation. It's Elizabethan English. Maybe in the day that's what it meant. But to us, it doesn't mean anything. Do you know what he really said? Oh, how happy you are, or hip, hip, hooray, or goody, goody. There's no translation into English of whatever this word is. It's an exclamatory thing like, it's just great that. And then he says a lot of stuff, some of which sound negative. But he's talking about bringing your consciousness to bear in so-called negative situations, and some positive ones. And let me read to you something that's a little more accurate in terms of translation. Oh, how happy are you when you know that you need spirituality. The heavenly kingdom belongs to you. Oh, how happy are those who are grieving. They will be comforted. Oh, how happy are the gentle and the humble. They will inherit the earth. Oh, how happy are those who hunger and thirst for the good. They will be completely satisfied. Oh, how happy are those who give mercy. They will receive mercy. Oh, how happy are those whose hearts are pure. They will see God. Oh, how happy are those who work for peace. They will be seen as God's children. Oh, how happy are those who've been treated badly for the sake of a higher ideal. The heavenly kingdom already belongs to them. And this is the big one. Oh, how happy are you when others put you down, reject you, or gossip about you maliciously because of me. Rejoice and be glad because you're going to receive a great and heavenly compensation. And just remember this. That's exactly how badly the prophets before you were treated. So what's he saying here? That whatever's going on in your outer world, you can untether yourself from the effects of it and move into the place that can self-regulate. You can stop being a thermometer and move to be a thermostat. You can move past even your religious differences and upbringing and move into a direct spiritual experience. That's what we're about. I had a guy I talked to this week, and it was in a completely unrelated area, and when he asked me what I did for a living, I told him, and he asked me, he says, what do you think in this world today? Is there a place for religion? And I said, not the way it's been taught, but if you go back to the original teachings of every world religion, it's a direct experience that's conveyed that a bunch of people make a bunch of rules. And I love this wonderful quote from a man who came to speak at my church many years ago. It was a church where we'd built 5 Habitat for Humanity houses, and the founder of Habitat came to speak, Millard Fuller, and he said something that I scribbled down. I got the tape and I scribbled it down real fast. So I've just shared it every few years in churches I've served. He said, "The family of God is so divided and can't agree on anything. So we kind of thought, wouldn't it be nice if we could agree on a hammer? After all, Jesus was a carpenter as a boy, and a hammer built his cross. So you can see a hammer can be used for good or for ill. So let's just say we're going to use it for good. So in that way, we've been able to bridge all kinds of differences. We can use anybody. If you have skills, we'll use you to help build a house. If you don't, why, we'll use you as a bad example. We can use anybody in Habitat. With that philosophy, we've been able to bring people together. There's so many differences in this world, but the one place, whether it's a hammer or whether it's the love in your heart, but there's something that holds us in common. There's something that we can agree on, and that's where we need to be putting our energy. That doesn't mean that you have to agree with all manner of egregious things, but you have to agree with their soul. You know, my ego personality can never agree with your ego personality, because that's the definition of ego personalities. They're separate. But my soul is one with your soul already, and even one with the soul of that person I see on TV that's speaking, or that person who is treating me badly, like Jesus said in the Beatitudes, which I like to call the Be Happy Attitudes, because it's a Be Happy Tudes, because it's your tood. Because it's really about bringing that wholeness within you and bringing it into the world. And you do that through taking a little time, maybe every day, to do a little spiritual practice, a little something for you, creating space in your life. I remember I learned the value of taking space in my life when I was an organist, the very first church where I was an organist. And the minister was in the hospital twice while I was there for exhaustion, because she would just go and go and go and go. And she wasn't doing too well in a lot of other areas too, because she was so driven, but she didn't have an internal life. It's strange being a minister, but it's very common. And so I watched her, and I found out later, she told me, the board met with her the third time that she was sent to the hospital. They said, "We're having you sign a contract. You've got to take one day off a week, 1 week off a month, and 1 month off a year where you don't have anything to do with the church." And with tongue in cheek, they said, you have to sign the contract or we'll fire you. But they loved her. But she did, and she did stay with that, and she lived a healthy life. And from that, I learned something. But in my first church, I still came down with a respiratory ailment that stuck with me for 6 weeks until I finally learned to create spaces in my life. And when I'm talking about self-care, I'm not talking about pleasure. I'm not talking about doing a bunch of things of excitement, although those are all fine things. I'll never forget when I was talking about in a class. It was a circle class. How are you going to take care of yourself spiritually? And a couple of people said, "I'm going to binge watch shows on Netflix." That's a good thing to do if it's a good show, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about creating reflective space, whether it's in nature or in your heart or the quietude of your soul, creating some space for yourself. And do you do that? Do you do enough of that? It doesn't have to be an egregious burden in your life, just a little bit all the time. And as I developed that skill, which I had to learn, like, you know, learning any skill, like learning golf or tiddlywinks, they asked me to come to the ministerial school more than once and teach the students about that, because that was one of the problems, is burnout. And burnout isn't how much you get done. In fact, when you're burning out, you get a lot less done. Have you ever found that out? If you create space in your life, it's like tithing. If you give it away, you get more. And if you create space in your life that's dedicated to your spiritual life, you receive more energy and you end up with more time. So, and it's so weird. You don't have time not to take the time to do your spiritual stuff, to journal out your negative feelings and get them out on paper and to release them, to do your reflective work. So what are you doing? And to what extent can you decide this stuff out here is not going to define me? I mean, when is enough enough? When you say to yourself, this isn't who I am. Together, this isn't who I am. I am that I am. Together, I am that I am. I've used a couple of affirmative prayer statements that for the last several months to help me detach from people, places, and things, and to give me a relative degree of sanity. And I want to share some of those with you. One of them is five meditation affirmations, and one is, I detach from all of this. None of this has anything to do with me. I rise above it all. None of this affects me. I take none of it personally. Now that sounds, some people might go, detachment, that's cold, that's distant. You can't really get anything done. No, it's the opposite, because it's a dynamic force that allows you to show up in the world and be fully present. Being fully present is your greatest spiritual experience. I have to share the story. A friend of mine, Uma Girish, who's written a couple of books for Hay House, she was teaching a workshop, and a woman had a near-death experience when she was on the operating table. And during it, she had something called a life review. How many people have heard of a life review? And it's where you kind of, you know, when they say his life passed before his eyes when he almost died. Well, it's like that, and that's a literal thing, and it really has happened, been documented in hundreds of thousands of cases. And in her life review, she was shown the greatest spiritual experience of her life, and it was when she was 7 years old, on her belly, in the yard, looking down at the ants, utterly and completely absorbed in the life of the ants at the age of seven. Now, I know a lot of you are thinking, I'm trying to kill the ants. What's he talking about? But think about this. Being present in a child's mind with the ants was her greatest spiritual experience. Does that fit any of your pictures? I'm glad. Because that means that, you know, Jesus said, you're never going to experience the kingdom of heaven until you become as a child. And the kingdom of heaven is the now moment experience of God. And what is a child? A child is open, authentic, real, right there, present, and completely absorbed in whatever's going on. And so you can be present with other people. You can be present with yourself. You can be present with life as it is. And as Martha Creek says, you can make friends with reality, honey. And so part of it is taking the things that come into your life and using them as the raw materials out of which you're creating, instead of trying to be stuck with outcomes. Again, Martha Creek, who will be here next week, once said, I'm not so much trying to get what I want, now I'm trying to want what I get. And then I work with it, and then I can move with it to try to create what it is I want. So the people who have had these near-death experiences get in touch with that inner part. Every one of them, and almost without exception, their lives are changed. They've done psychological studies of people who've had near-death experiences where they get to experience their inner self, their soul, and then they're resuscitated later, and they find out that their values change, their lives change. They are completely in a different space. And this is a really freaky one. I didn't share this at 9:30, but they did a study of prisoners who were diagnosed psychopaths in prison who died on the operating table or had an accident and were resuscitated and had near-death experiences. Almost without exception, they stopped being psychopathic. They were retested because they got in touch with that part of themselves that was real, that shared with everybody else, and they began to have empathy for other people. Think about that. You can cultivate the experience. I'm not suggesting that you do something to get a near-death experience. But I am suggesting that you can get the same effect in your life by getting in touch with that sacred something that's in your heart through these little practices that you do on a daily basis, that you make a part of yourself, this genuine part of yourself. It's the real part of yourself. It's the part that the world is desiring from you. It is that God in you that is waking up. You know, God is waking up in the world. It sure doesn't look like it, but that's how it's looking, because it's part of, we're letting go of the tether. And sometimes we fumble a lot to let go of the tether, and it may take years and decades, but we're working on it. But your position in the vanguard of that soul spiritual movement of humanity is to be the eyes and ears of God and to wake up maybe a little advanced of the rest of the people and bring your presence to what? To reality. So I'm going to take us into a little meditation here using those affirmative prayer statements that I was sharing. And I'm going to add a couple more that I use as well. And so just take the world as it is, or perhaps it's a situation that you're trying to let go of that you've been tethered to. And just take these as your true statements as you get back in touch with your smiling heart. And your heart is smiling there, and your face reflects that smile of your heart. And you take these words together in a silent space that we share, and we just silently affirm, I detach from all of this. None of this has anything to do with me. I rise above it all. None of this affects me. I take none of it personally. And my personality is powerless over my judgments, but I come to believe that a power greater than I am can restore me to sanity, and I'm willing that the will of God be done. And I just rest for a moment in this detached space. Thank you, thank you, thank you, God. And so it is. Amen.